For the first time, Americans today are not free to say what they think. If they say something deemed offensive or insensitive or, worst of all, hate speech, they may be in serious trouble. They may be punished for violating the unholy commandments of the 90s, commonly known as political correctness. But is political correctness a new phenomenon? We'll show you tonight that political correctness has been in the making for more than 8 decades. And it seems that a deteriorating society is exactly what political correctness strives for. But just what is political correctness? As you're about to see, political correctness is nothing less than a Marxist ideology. Marxism translated from economic into cultural terms in an effort going back not to the 1960s, but to World War I.
Marxist theory had predicted that if war came to Europe, the working class in every European country would rise in revolt. But that theory proved wrong. When the First World War began in 1914, the workers' loyalty to their country proved stronger than their so-called class consciousness. They willingly put on their uniforms, French or German, Austrian or Russian or British, and marched off by the millions to fight each other. In 1917, a Marxist revolution did occur in Russia, but it failed to spread to Western Europe, again contradicting orthodox Marxist theory.
At the war's end, Marxist theorists had to confront the question, what had gone wrong? Antonio Gramsci in Italy and Georg Lukács in Hungary believed they had the answer.
Gramsci and Lukács argued that Western culture had blinded the working class to its true Marxist class interests. Before a Marxist revolution could take place, Western culture had to be destroyed. In 1919, Lukács, who was considered the most brilliant Marxist theorist since Marx himself, asked, who will save us from Western civilization? That same year, 1919, Lukács became deputy commissar for culture in the Bolshevik Belakun government in Hungary, where he launched a program of cultural terrorism. As part of that program, Lukács introduced a radical sex education program into the Hungarian schools. Political correctness, as we know it, was already beginning to take form.
He tried to actually undermine the unity of the family, and that was one of the reasons that he tried to introduce sex education.
Laszlo Pastor, a leader in the Hungarian resistance against the communist takeover of Hungary after World War II, explains why children were targeted.
It's always much tougher to convert an adult, you know, to do something what he was taught not to do.
The program left great residual effects on Hungary.
The only thing what we were permitted to accept as far as culture is concerned, what they were teaching, that was it. Free thinking was a very big sin.
The Belakun government lasted only a few months, in part because the Hungarian working class was outraged by Georg Lukács' assault on traditional Western culture. But meanwhile, in Germany, a new attempt to create a Marxist critique of Western culture was taking shape. There, the wealthy young son of a millionaire grain trader, Felix Weil, wanted to establish a public policy institute, a think tank, to serve as a home for advanced Marxist thought. Modeled on the Marx-Engels Institute in Moscow, Weil's think tank was originally to be named the Institute for Marxism. Martin Jay, chairman of the history department at Berkeley, an author of a history of the Frankfurt School, explains why the name was changed to the Institute für Sozialforschung, the Institute for Social Research.
But I think they were very interested in trying to avoid being overly labeled. So it's a fairly bland name, the Institute of Social Research.
The Institute was affiliated with Frankfurt University in Frankfurt, Germany, and in time became known simply as the Frankfurt School. The Frankfurt School formally opened its doors on June 22, 1924, but it had already held its first seminar on theory in the spring of 1923. There, almost 24 Marxist scholars gathered for what Weil, the sponsor, called a Marxist study week. One of the participants was Richard Sorge, later a famous Soviet spy. Another was Georg Lukács. Lukács's writings on culture were the basis for much of the program. Almost half of the participants in this Marxist study week would later be affiliated with the Frankfurt School.
Following Lukács's lead, the Frankfurt School would be the vehicle that translated Marxism from economic into cultural terms, giving us what we now know as political correctness.
The Frankfurt School's first director was an Austrian Marxist economist, Karl Greenberg. Greenberg's principal effort was to firmly establish the Institute's Marxist nature. In his inaugural address, which opened the Institute's new building in Frankfurt, Greenberg said,
"It has been our intention here from the outset to maintain uniformity in the way we look at problems and go about solving them. I, too, am one of the opponents of the economic, social, and legal order which has been handed down to us from history. And I, too, am one of the supporters of Marxism. In the new research institute, Marxism will from now on have a home."
Under Karl Greenberg, the Frankfurt School worked mostly on economic questions and the labor movement, conventional Marxist subjects. But in 1930, Greenberg was replaced as director by a young Marxist intellectual with very different ideas, Max Horkheimer. Horkheimer quickly began to use the Institute to develop a new Marxism, very different from the Marxism of the Soviet Union.
First, recognizing the economic success of capitalism, Horkheimer announced that revolution was unlikely to come from the working class. The Frankfurt School would have to find a substitute.
Well, this was the great question. The great question is there a surrogate for the working class?
The Frankfurt School would not find an answer to this question until the 1960s. But meanwhile, Horkheimer moved to revive Lukács's work by making the culture, not the economy, the central focus of the Frankfurt School's work. As Martin J. writes in his History of the Frankfurt School, The Dialectical Imagination, if it can be said that in the early years of its history, the Institute concerned itself primarily with an analysis of bourgeois society's socioeconomic substructure, in the years after 1930, its prime interest lay in its cultural superstructure. Indeed, the traditional Marxist formula regarding the relationship between the two was called into question.
The key to the Frankfurt School's work on culture was the crossing of Marx with Freud. Just as classical economic Marxism argued that under capitalism, the working class was oppressed, so the Frankfurt School used Freud to argue that under Western culture, everyone lived in a constant state of psychological repression.
So there were radical Freudians during this period who had hopes of using psychoanalysis to end what Reich had called sexual alienation, which they saw as significant as economic alienation.
The solution, according to the Frankfurt School, was not just a political revolution to overthrow capitalism, but a social and cultural revolution as well. To further the Institute's work on cultural issues, Horkheimer brought in some new blood. The new members included a sometime music critic, Theodor Adorno. Martin J. sees this addition as critical.
Well, Adorno is perhaps the most fecund and brilliant of all the members of the Frankfurt School.
Another new member was Eric Fromm. Fromm, a practicing psychoanalyst, was noted for his radical Marxist social psychology. He pioneered the concept of sexual liberation and gender politics. According to Martin Jay, in Fromm's view, masculinity and femininity were not reflections of essential sexual differences. They were derived instead from differences in life functions, which were in part socially determined.
Another piece of political correctness was falling into place.
In 1932, Herbert Marcuse became a member of the Institute for Social Research. Marcuse would ultimately become the most important member of the Frankfurt School for the development of political correctness. In the 1950s and 60s, Marcuse would complete the translation of Marxism into cultural terms and inject it into the New Left. Martin Jay sums it up.
In which Marcuse in the United States represented the most radical inclinations of the school, in a sense continuing the work they had done in the 1920s and into the 30s, a work that was inspired by Marxist Hegelian philosophy, very interested in the crisis both of capitalism and liberal democracy, trying to find alternatives to the working class.
As we've seen, the Frankfurt School, Marxist in origin, wanted to create a cultural revolution against Western society. And in the 1930s, they took their important first step. In the 1930s, the work of Horkheimer, Adorno, Frome, and Marcuse issued in its first tangible product, critical theory.
The term critical theory is something of a play on words. One is tempted to ask, what is the theory? The answer is, the theory is to criticize. Through unremitting, destructive criticism of every institution of Western society, they hope to bring that society down. Critical theory is the basis for gay studies, black studies, women's studies, and various other studies departments found on American university campuses today. These departments are the home base of political correctness.